Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we thank you this time that we can come boldly before the throne of grace in the name of Jesus. We're fully aware, Lord, that we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man. We're fully aware that we haven't come in to hear from a woman. We haven't come to hear from a black man, white man. We haven't come from a tall man or old man or young man. We haven't come to hear a short man. We haven't come to hear anybody but the teacher of the church, who is the Holy Spirit. So Holy Spirit, put me on. Here I am. Let's talk to your people today about what you would have them to hear and to do and to operate, so they can be all that you've called them to do, be and do all that you've called them to do all the days of their life. And God will give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you, Father, for a mighty move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives this night. As you bless us, bless all the churches in the Inland Empire that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we'll give you the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say,
amen.
Amen. I have a message that's been on my heart for a long time. And I actually heard another preacher preaching something like it, and it just stimulated my mind and my thought, and it changed my thinking a lot. And for months, I haven't been able to think too much about too many other things. And I'm just wanting to share with you tonight. It's called the message, if you want to make notes, it's called Dealing with Your Generational Traits. We all have stuff that we deal with that we got from somebody else. You know, some of you need to realize that you are what you are because someone passed down through the gene pool their traits. Sometimes it's the size of a person. Sometimes it's the color of the person's hair or skin. Sometimes it's even their teeth and their eyes. They're all generational traits that are passed down through our DNA. A lot of times we settle for them. If they're good, we say, great, you know, this is a good thing. It's something I'll hold on to. But if it's bad, we make an excuse. And the excuse is often, this is the way I'm born. I'm born like this. I'll do this because, it's the way I am. It's the way my family was. It's what my dad was like. It must be what my mom was like. And we live our lives based oftentimes on a generational, if you will, DNA, the genes that are passed to us, instead of the new family that we live in and the new bloodline that we have washed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we don't realize that oftentimes. For an example, throughout all of our life, I'm gonna give you a sentence right now as an example. Throughout our life, we made this statement. You finish the statement, tell me what you think. And here's the statement. That boy is just like his father. Or you'll find, you know, the mother is just giving off and the daughter is just like the mother. And sometimes we take these statements and we play them out as Christians as the more important thing than even the things that God has for us. This is the way we are. This is how it is. You know, I have a temper because my dad had a temper. I have some insecurities in my life because my mother was insecure. You know, I have this nervous habit because my parents had a nervous habit. I'm an alcoholic because my parents were alcoholics. I'm a drug addict because my parents were drug addicts. And we make excuses, and we literally come to a place in our life where what we do is we really stop the things that God has for us and the blessings that are ahead of us. When someone makes a statement that a father like a son, or the apple doesn't fall too far from the, what is the word, tree, we know what we're talking about. But is that the way it really is when you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? I mean, are you really in bondage to what your parents did and didn't do? Are you really in there stuck and you can't do anything about it? You know, if one was frustrated all the time, one was negative all the time, one had no peace all the time, then I guess for Christians that's the way it is, because, you know, it's really in our DNA, it's really in our makeup, our generational makeup, our genes. And that's why the title of this message is so important for us, dealing with your generational traits. If I can make a statement, I think it's interesting. It's been proven that if your mother or father was an alcoholic, there's 10 times more chance of you becoming an alcoholic. But does that have to happen? And that's the question all of us need to ask ourselves. Recently, everything that you have and I have has been passed down through spiritual DNA by our parents, good and bad, as I just mentioned. But also, we found out something that we find that genetic testing has done something recently, and they've uncovered something in the gene pool that is called, if you will, epigenetics. Epigenetics is something that most people don't ever really think about, but epigenetics is really interesting. It means they take a gene and they found that over the gene is a covering. In other words, you have the traits, and you have the gene that was passed on from the parents, but you don't have to activate that gene because of this epigenetics that is covering the gene. And a lot of times they're finding out that even though the gene may be in the body, but it's dormant because other things take its place. They found out the decisions that a person makes can eliminate genes that are passed from parent to child. They found out that the environment that the child is raised in can eliminate the power of that gene. They can find out that the experiences of the life of that person that has the gene can be null and void, even though that DNA is in their body, because of the experiences of life. And most importantly, they found out that the genes that are in us, that were passed to us, that were not of God, but really of man, and really contrary to the ways of God, can be eliminated and removed and null and void in your life and in mine through something called choice. Wow. That just blows me away when a scientific experiment like that comes along and solidifies what the Word of God has to say. You know, the Bible makes it very clear that greater is he that's in us than he that is in the world. Is anybody listening? And oftentimes we don't listen to that at all. And sometimes we've got to come to a place in every one of our decision-making processes as Christians that the natural world is superseded by the spiritual world. In other words, the natural is very real, but there's a power greater than the natural world, and it's the spiritual world. So the natural world can be changed by the spiritual world. And a lot of people say, oh, you know, that's crazy. That doesn't make sense at all. In other words, literally, we find all through the scripture, don't we, that the natural world is actually overpowered by the supernatural, spiritual world. So whatever was natural could be changed by the spiritual awakening of the person on the inside. And we fail to see that all the time. We fail to activate it. So what I'm finding out is if I can deactivate, or if you will, make null and void those DNA things that I'm carrying, those traits that were not of God, that were passed along from my parents and grandparents before that, if I can make them null and void, then I can also activate godly principles, because I now have a new family, don't I? The Bible says that you actually have new spiritual family and that you literally are in the family of God. Really fascinating when we look at how the natural world is superseded by the spiritual world. We don't want to think of them in those terms, but did you know that when you came forward tonight, many of you, for healing, You're coming forward with a natural feeling that you know that you know that you hurt and you don't feel good. There's no doubt about it. I'm not questioning that at all. But what you came forward for is because inside of you, you knew that there's a spiritual awakening that can supersede that natural feeling that you have on the inside. And you came forward right out of your seat in order that the natural world that you are living in would be superseded by the spiritual world that you know exists. In Matthew, I'm going to take you to the scripture. Let me show you that if I can in the life of Jesus in the 14th chapter. In fact, let's turn there together. Matthew, the 14th chapter. And let's take a look as Jesus is doing something really fascinating in the 25th verse of the 14th chapter. Matthew 14, 25, it says, "Now in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went to them," and listen to these words, "walking on the water." Wait a minute, I don't know if you got that or not, but you just saw the natural world penetrated by the supernatural, spiritual world, and Jesus is breaking a natural, physical principle. If Jesus can break a natural, physical principle, which is walking on water. I remember one time when I was young, Debbie and I first got married. Jessica probably was, I don't know, 3 or 4 years old. I don't know where Luke was. He might have been there somewhere just coming into the world or not. But we had our first swimming pool. We rented a house in Redlands, and I'll never forget it. I'll never forget it as long as I live. It was on the side. They had a little swimming pool, and Debbie could hardly wait to dive in that pool. I remember one time, you know, she was young in those days, and she tested the water, and she says, "Well, it's about 67. That's good enough," and she dove in. Oh, my goodness. She jumped out of that water. She thought, "Oh, this is ridiculous. You know, it's just so cold." And I'll never forget one day being so spiritual. I said to God, "God," I was out there by myself. And I said, "God, Jesus could walk on water. I'm going to walk on water too." And I was just a dumb kid in my 30s. And I actually stepped off the side, went right down to the bottom, just popped back up, got out of the water, all soaking wet, clothes on and everything, all soaking wet. I'll never forget, there was a neighbor looking over the fence. And I felt so stupid, but that's a natural principle, is you're not going to walk on water. And here you see the natural superseded by the spiritual. It goes on in verse number 26, and he says this, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled," saying, why were they troubled? Because it was natural. It was unnatural. It was a principle he was breaking by the Spirit. You see, the principles that you have a DNA on the inside of you that controls who you are, what you are, how you act, how you think, how you react, and nothing can change that because that's the way you were born, is totally and completely ridiculous. And that verse proves it right there. And there's hundreds of them from the Old Testament, New Testament, where God supersedes the natural with a spiritual insight. And he says these words, "It's a ghost," and they cried out, verse number 27. Remember this. "But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'Be of good cheer, it is I, do not be afraid.' And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water, on the water, on the water.'" Peter says, "I'm going to." Now here's, I can understand Jesus walking on the water. But now we're going to see that the natural was defeated by the spiritual with Peter. He says, "Command that I come to you." And he says this word in verse number 29. He says, "And Jesus said, 'Come.' And Peter had come down out of the boat. He walked on the water to go to Jesus." He's on the water. So someone says, "Yeah, well, I can understand that Jesus is spiritual and he can change, you know, he can speak to the natural wind. Be silent, be still. The storms that rise up in life and the waves all calm down. He takes his spirituality and he changes the natural world." But here you see man doing it. And it's in there for that reason, that you can see man actually walking. And all of a sudden, Peter gets his eyes off Jesus. You know how the story goes. And he starts to sink because he saw the waves and the wind. A lot of times we think we're stuck. When in fact, listen to me, my friends, hear me. You're not stuck at all. You're stuck in the foolish thinking of man that says you were born this way and that's the way it is. Can I just make one statement about that principle? We're all born as sinners, but Jesus makes a statement: in order for you to be saved, you must be converted. So whatever you were born, you were a sinner, and whatever it's going to take to get saved, you're going to have to be converted. Converted to what? Converted to his ways. Simple as that. Simple as that. Case closed on everything. Because the natural is really superseded by the spiritual. And so important for us to see. I have a granddaughter by the name of Chloe. She's just about as cute as she possibly is. Mama, how old is Chloe right now? She's 10. And Chloe is a clean freak. She likes everything clean. She washes her hands numerous times a day. She likes picking up stuff. She doesn't like anything dirty. She just is a clean freak. Chloe actually gets that from her mom. Her mom got it from me. I got it from my mom. Those two on the front row don't have that gene. But I've got that gene. And it's passed down. And a lot of times we don't realize if it's a good gene, great. If it's a bad gene, then we don't need to tolerate it any longer. Because here's the deal. When you know you don't have to tolerate the way you are, and you do, that's a crazy lifestyle you're living. And you don't have to live that life. And God hadn't called you to be crazy. A woman not too long ago made a statement that she has anorexia. Because she was anorexic, she was really had major health problems. And she made a statement that her mother was anorexic. And then she went on to say that her grandmother was anorexic. And all of that was a gene that was passed along, and the child received it and ran with it as that's the way it is, never changing it, but tolerating it, and therefore her existence is now being defeated. What would have happened if she rose up and said, wait a minute, I'm a child of God. I don't have to put up with this. I'm healed by the stripes of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In him I live. And it would have been a completely different thing. All by choices. And a lot of times we don't realize. In 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter, I'll read it to you. We'll put it up on the overhead. Verse number 17 says it like this. Watch this. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, I love the word if. Biggest little word in the Bible is the word if. That means it's optional whether you're going to do this or not do this. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. One translation says new creature. I think it's the old King James. Some of your Bibles may say that. New creature. Old things have passed away. I mean, yes, but you know, this is my mom and dad's DNA. My mom was this way. My dad was this way. My mom was a worrier. I'm a worrier. My dad was a smoker. I'm a smoker. My mom was an angry person. I'm an angry person. My dad was a drug addict. I'm a drug addict. My mom was an alcoholic. I'm an alcoholic. In other words, stop blaming your parents and listen to what the Word of God says. It says all things, doesn't say some things. Does that mean your DNA? Yes. Does that mean your genetic inheritance? Yes. It says have become what? Oh, come on, you got to play with me tonight. All those things, when you become in Christ, everything in your existence becomes, because you're a new creature, becomes what's the word?
New.
And like this, verse 18 says this. Again, he says it again, just so there's no misunderstanding. Two times in two verses. Now, because of that, all things are of God. The problem with that is we don't let it be of God. We let it be the genetic transfer from our parents when we don't have to, because there's a covering over that gene that you don't have to activate it. You can deactivate it by your choices, by your activities, by your own belief system, and by the things that you do. Fascinating to me. Ernest Hemingway, great author. How many of you heard of Ernest Hemingway? Fabulous author and well famous writer, was cursed with a lifestyle of alcoholism, depression, negativity, and suicidal tendencies plagued him all of his life. He took his life in suicide in 1961. The tragedy of all of that is that his sister committed suicide 5 years later. Most people don't know this, but you'll find that his brother committed suicide 16 years later. See, and a lot of times we don't hear about this and see it for the truth. But then his granddaughter committed suicide in 1996. The interesting thing about Ernest Hemingway is his father, back in the year of 1925, committed suicide. It ran through his entire family. It was a suicide gene. And until somebody breaks the gene by changing their activity and their belief system and says, no, I'm not putting up with that. I've got the blood of the Lord behind me. It's going to continue on. Can you imagine what this family history would have been like if somebody back in the 20s took authority over that foul, demonic gene and did the thing that was right and believed God for it? It's just amazing how stupid we could be. And oftentimes we just follow like everybody else. If someone doesn't stand up and say no, the curse will keep on going for hundreds of years. This is not just about you. Now, listen to what I'm going to say to you. It's important that you get free. It's important that you live healthy. It's important that you live up to all that God paid for on that cross at Calvary. The lifestyle to be a witness to a lost and dying world that is out there. And that's why we see this scripture in Deuteronomy, the 30th chapter, verse number 19, says these words. Here we see this great word of God coming forth. I call heaven and earth as a witness, God is speaking, today against you, that I have set before you life and death. And then he defines what that is, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life, that both you and your descendants may live. Notice how it's not just about you. It's about your children's, children's, children's. You can break whatever that is. Now, you don't have to wait for it. Sometimes what we do is we foolishly follow people because we've seen it when we grew up. We saw the ugliness of somebody, and then all of a sudden we start to act ugly like them because we saw them ugly and we saw that as right instead of wrong. I'll never forget my son Luke drove me nuts as a father. Oh, don't misunderstand me. We drove me nuts in a different way. He was the only one in the family that never caused any problems. I mean, he was like crazy. All the rest of the kids I wanted to hang. Luke was just as good as, he was a little goody two-shoes. Drove me nuts, you know what I mean? And I would, you know, I was a new pastor in those days. I hadn't gotten rid of, nobody taught me about getting rid of these cursings and choose life and I could be different. I didn't know. So every now and then the old man would come up and it would express itself. You know what I'm talking about with high school words. And don't look at me like you never use them. And Luke would look at me and he was like, this little kid coming up to me, and he'd say, Dad, pastors don't act like that. Pastors don't talk like that. And I would just have this natural response. Oh, shut up, son, you're only four. How do you know? It was like, where did he come from, Mom? It's like God dropped him out of heaven or something like that, you know? Like, what is this? And it was like the craziest thing in the world. But it was so true. He was telling me I didn't have to be the way I was. And the neat thing about it is he doesn't have to be the way he is. And what's his DNA on the inside of him? All the anger and all the frustration and all that. So he doesn't have to do that. I hope his wife, if he ever acts like a non-Christian and non-pastor, makes this statement to him. Luke, pastors don't act like that. But we don't have to act like our parents act. We don't have to live like they lived. We don't have to be like them. We're different. We're born of the Spirit of God. We've got a future ahead of us. The natural doesn't control us, but the spiritual does overcome the natural. Come on, somebody. There's this wonderful little verse in Ezekiel that I want to point out to you. And I'll just take you to Ezekiel. If you want to find the book of Daniel, right in front of the book of Daniel, around the same time as Daniel the prophet was Ezekiel, time of the Babylonian captivity. In Ezekiel, go with me to the 18th chapter of Ezekiel. It's really a bizarre verse. And I'll explain the verse to you so that you can understand it and see it for what it really is. Is that okay? God is angry with Israel because Israel is making an excuse. They call upon an old proverb. The proverb, I'll read it to you in a minute, is a proverb that says, because my parents were this way, I'm that way too. And God puts a commandment on Israel, never use that proverb again. And the reason for it is because I'm your father and you belong to me, not your earthly fathers. And it's like a wow of a statement. Listen to this in Ezekiel, the 18th chapter. In fact, I'll take you to verse number 1. And the word of the Lord came to me again, saying, what do you mean when you use the proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge? One time, Debbie gave me, she loves sour candy. The more sour, the better. And I hate sour. Anybody like sour? Come on, raise your hand. Half you do and half you don't. I'm on the other side. I like sweet candy, not sour. She handed me one of those one time. I was driving. I spit that sucker out. It hit the windshield in front of me. Oh, my goodness. It gave me the, I went, ugh. See that expression? Let me try it again. Look at me. Ugh. Can you feel it? Can you feel the sour? Ugh. And that's what he's saying in this verse. The fathers ate the sour grapes and the kids are going, ugh. They're feeling what their father's done. And he says, I'm your father. Don't ever use that again. Don't ever use that excuse. A lot of times, we Christians make excuses for our bad activities and our bad lifestyles, for iniquities and sins. We make excuses for the way we act or treat people instead of being what God would have us to be. We make excuses when we're weak in our faith, and we make excuses when we're worried about our bills. We make excuses when we have anxiety and we stay up all night long. We make excuses when we suck down too many drinks to try to get away from the problems of the world. Or we shoot up too much drugs because, you know, that's what it is. We make excuses when we use something to comfort our life instead of God. Because we're like those people who are following after the DNA. The DNA will be the trait that is always in you, but it's covered up as long as you put something in its place. And that's the word of God.
I want to read to you if I can, and I'm going to do this right because I wrote this down. It's important that you hear this, and I'll close with this. It's really fascinating. I don't want to mess it up, so I'm going to read it to you. Is that okay? I want you to listen. I was going to put it up in the overhead, but I didn't have time. 1874, six people from the same family were in a New York prison. A member of the New York State Prison Board decided to trace the family history because he was surprised at six family members being in the prison. He went back as far as he could. He went back to the date of 1720 to a man named Max Jukes. Max Jukes was known to be a troublemaker, a heavy drinker, a fighter, brawler, a rude man with no integrity whatsoever. How fascinating. And he married a woman just exactly like himself. They had six daughters and two sons. The 1,200 descendants of Max Jukes were studied. Here's what they found from his descendants. 310 of them ended up homeless and living their life out in the streets. 180 of them were alcoholics. 160, remember this is the 1800s now. 160 were drug addicts. 150 were criminals in prison. And seven were murderers. At the same time, they went back and they researched another family and studied his lineage to about the same time, and they found a man by the name of Jonathan Edwards, known to be a great man of God, a theologian. He was actually the president of Princeton University. He was born in 1703. He married Sarah. He was married for 31 years before he died. They had 11 children. And the 1,400 of his descendants were studied. See if there's a difference between the man of God and the one who didn't have and want God. 13 college presidents. 66 professors, 100 attorneys, 85 authors of classical books, 32 of them were state judges, 66 of them were doctors, 80 held public offices, including three governors of the state, three U.S. senators, and one United States vice president. What a difference. This is not about you. And it's not just about me. This is about those that will come after you. One man broke the curse by following Jesus. One man decided to follow his own ways and left a tragedy. What would it have been like if he had turned his life around and started believing God's word? Some people say, well, how do I do that, Pastor? Well, maybe you ought to get in a group. You know, that says in James, the 5th chapter, verse number 60, that we confess our sins one to another. Maybe you need to join Breaking Free and get this off of you. Maybe you need to be part of a group that'll help you and, you know, that you can, what do they call that, to be accountable to them. Maybe you can, my best friend was Deborah. Wasn't very long after we were married, she said something to me, I'll never forget it, the kids weren't even born. She says, I'm not going to stay married to you if you continue with that bad temper. I said, what bad temper? She says, you have a horrible temper. I said, I do? She says, of course you do.
and you can do something about it with Jesus Christ. And I was just a young man. I never thought about getting expelled from baseball because I fought too much. I was a professional baseball player with what was called the Kansas City Athletics. Now they're called the Oakland Athletics. But when they released my contract because I was such a fighter, this is your pastor, by the way. Because I was such a fighter, they sent me home. And they said, now tear up your own house. We're tearing up your contract. And I tore up my house. When there was a fight on the field, I was the first one in the fight. Last one off the fight. If there was nobody else on the field, I would go into the audience. That's your pastor. And Deborah said, because she was my closest friend, she said, I'm not going to live with you like that. You need to deal with it. And I dealt with it. And I still have the traits. Can you tell sometimes? But I don't ever express it. Even when Debbie and I fight, I shut up. I'd really like to knock her out sometimes, but I shut up. And I yell back, I just love you. It makes her madder, actually. I do it on purpose. But the point being is this, you don't have to be what your DNA says you have. You still have the trait, but it's covered up. My question is, what's it covered up with? I think it's covered up with, they haven't found this to be a fact. I think it's covered up with the spiritual DNA of God himself that says that trait doesn't have to come out. What you need to do is make a choice for God and let that trait come out. And I've done that for 40 years of marriage, and I'm here to tell you, it works. All our kids are in ministry. All our children preaching the gospel, loving God. It's not that we don't occasionally fall back on those traits, but as soon as we do, we get out of it and get back to God. And that's what this is all about. I'm just waiting for Luke to make a mistake. I'm going to say the first words to him. I'm going to say, Pastor Luke, pastors don't talk that way. I haven't yet got him, but I'm waiting. If anybody got anything out of this tonight, give the Lord a great big praise. Will you do that? Good to be in the house of the Lord. When I was a young man, someone asked me, do you believe in Jesus? I said, yes. He said, oh, good, then you're a Christian. That's a lie. That's not true. Someone needs to tell you. The devil believes in Jesus, and he's not a Christian. A lot of people believe in Jesus with their head, but they don't believe in Jesus with their heart. And that's what it says in scriptures, that you believe with your heart. And then it says that you believe so much that it's unto righteousness. Two words we in American churches for 250 years have totally forgotten about. It's pretty amazing. So when someone came along and made that statement to me, and he didn't say any more than that, I thought I was okay with God, because he said, if you believe, then you're a Christian. He didn't define what that meant, but I'm defining it for you. Because, you know, you can believe in Jesus enough to go to church at Christmas and Easter, still die and go to hell. You can believe in Jesus enough to not be against Jesus, but not be wholehearted for Jesus, die and go to hell. You can believe in Jesus to go to church once in a while and not be offended, but then you can die and go to hell. You can believe in Jesus enough to sing in a choir or join a church and then die and go to hell. Because the belief that God's talking about is not head knowledge, which I'm afraid to report to you that most Americans have head knowledge about Jesus and not heart relationship with the depth of the heart unto righteousness. A lot of things we need to talk about tonight, but let me just make this clear. Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there any other way. Listen, you can get out of your seat, come up and get healed by Jesus, die, and go to hell. You can come to church tonight, die, and go to hell. Because until you do it Jesus' way, you haven't done it at all. Somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. That's what I'm doing right now, telling you the truth. You cannot get to heaven your way, my way, or some well-meaning church committee's way. You got to get to heaven Jesus' way, and I'll tell you what that is in a minute. You cannot get to heaven because you're a good person. Most people in American churches think they're good enough to get to heaven, they're going to make it. You know, you're pretty good, I guess you're going to make it. That's not what God's looking for, and you're not going to make it. You cannot get to heaven because you hope you're going to make it, like whoever's the greatest hoper makes it. You cannot get to heaven because you joined the church, sang in a choir, like I said, count the offering, help the pastor out. You can't do that. In order for you to get to heaven, you're going to have to do it Jesus' way. Now watch this. He tells us exactly what that way is in John 3rd chapter. He says you must be born again. I know, as soon as I use the words born again, all of American churches go, oh, I'm just totally turned off to born again people. They're like radical idiots and fanatics, but that's not what Jesus is talking about. And the reason you have that opinion is because of Hollywood movies and stories and television that made Christians look like a bunch of idiots. And that's not what he's talking about. To be born again means something. And let me explain to you what it means quickly so that you can leave tonight and make a choice. It means that you have given God all of your heart. It means you've given God all of your life. It's a all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It always has been. It always will be. All or nothing. All or nothing. I'll prove it to you. In fact, the last book of the Bible, you've heard of it, the book of Revelation. Jesus says these words, I'm coming again, and you know he is, but we just don't know when. And he says, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because watch this, if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. You won't make it if I find you lukewarm. So lukewarm Christianity is not gonna get there. It's not real Christianity at all. He says, I better find you hot or cold. Lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. What is lukewarm? Let me define it for you. Is that okay? Little in, little out, little up, little down. Token prayer every now and then, occasional church attendance. You're not against God, but watch this. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not against him, but you're really not wholehearted for him. You're going to be left behind, my friend, and someone needs to tell you. It's believing with all of your heart unto righteousness. Whew, that's a big call. And only you can do it by giving God all of your heart. You see, he's not a thief. He won't rob your heart. The guy caught me at the door not too long ago, said, if God wants my heart, he'll take it. No, he doesn't do that. He's not a conniver. He's not a thief. He's not a manipulator. He's not going to talk you into it. He's totally a gentleman, and it's your call. He gave you a free will choice to give him all of your heart and give him all of your life. So you're sitting there tonight and you haven't yet done that, then tonight is your night of salvation. Welcome to church. And you're here for a reason. You have a divine appointment with God. You've had a lot of appointments, doctors and attorneys and painters and plumbers. But tonight God brought you here because you have a divine appointment with God. That's what this is all about. Don't miss your appointment with God. Here it is. God wants you to get right with him by giving him all of your heart and all of your life. You say, well, Pastor Jim, how do I do that? How do I give God all my heart? How do I give God all my life? Well, let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. In other words, in a moment, what you're going to do publicly is going to make a statement in the heavens and before God the Father himself, creator of the heavens and the earth. You say, well, how does that work? Well, let's do it Jesus' way. Jesus said, if you confess me, I'll confess you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go like this. One, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! You hear that sound? Bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand. What you're saying, now watch this. What you're saying by raising your hand is I don't want Jesus in my head like most Americans. I already got him there. I want to give him all of my heart, give him all of my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven. And I want Jesus. And that's your freedom right there, is when you give him all of your heart and all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship. But you got to do it. I can't make you do it. But who should raise your hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. If you're one of those people in here and you've never given him all of your life, come on, you know what I'm talking about. You've never given him to him. Maybe you're one of those people in here that don't know for sure whether you have or haven't. Maybe you prayed with Billy Graham one time or you uttered a prayer at a Harvest Crusade. But did you follow through that prayer with all of your heart and life? Because God doesn't just hear a formula of words and let you in heaven. He watches your heart and life that follows your heart to see if your prayer was real. So easy. Today, in the safe, friendly place, we've laughed, we've clapped, we've sung. You got ministered to. God already touched so many of you. Why leave this place the same? Today, make sure, give God all of your heart. Make sure, give God all of your life. I'm talking all across the back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, even in the foyer, if you're watching by television. Tonight is your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three. Sit there and do nothing. Or get your hand up before God. Let him see it. Let me see it. And then put it right back down. Tonight is your night. You say, Pastor, wait a minute. Hold on. Stop. I'll feel funny if I raise my hand. I'll be embarrassed. Uh-huh. You might be. Get over it. That gene is no longer going to control your life doing the wrong things and making the wrong choices. Make the right one for God. You can do it. Get your hand up and put it right back down. Better to be embarrassed for a moment than to be in hell forever and ever because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. Tonight's your night of salvation. I'm counting to three. I've done my job. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands. There's one. Thank you. There's two, three, four, five. Thank you. Back here. Six, seven. Thank you. Eight, nine, ten. Thank you. 11 back over here. There's 12 on that far side. Anybody over this side? 12. All the sinners sat on that side tonight. You guys are cool, right? Okay. Oh, there's thank you. Thank you. 13, 14. Thank you. God bless you. There's 15 back over here. Gotcha. 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 Good, good, good. There's 15. What do you think? You think 15 is pretty cool? Anybody believe for 16? Can you just feel 16? Don't raise your hand and say, yeah, I believe for 16. I'll count you. I just know there's another one out there that you know you need to get your hand up. And you're saying to yourself, I really need to do this. I should do this. I didn't embarrass him. I won't embarrass you. Real quick, I'll look over the audience one more time. It's your call whether you do it or not. Are you number 16? Then get your hand up. Get your hand up. Anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, thank you, Jesus, for 15. Let's give the Lord a great big praise. Here's what I want you to do. Real quick before we dismiss everybody. Let's invite those 15 people that raised their hand. If you're one of the people that raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, but you know you should have, why don't you get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend, get your stuff, get out of your seat, get in the aisle, meet me right here in front. Nobody leave during this period of time because that discourages people from coming forward. So if you raised your hand, you should have raised your hand, get your stuff, meet me right here. Come on, come on, come on home.
Jesus, I believe.
Come on home if you raise your hand. You're serious about God. Get out of your seat and come, 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 come.
You're the reason that I live.
Come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on. Bring a friend if you need to. Just come.
Jesus, I belong.
Oh, they're coming, give them a hand as they come. Come on. They're coming, give them a hand.
Jesus, I believe.
They're coming, give them a hand as they come. Come on.
Jesus, I believe.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you. All of you in front, God bless you. Put a smile on your face. This is a good day, not a bad day. You're not going to die and go to hell. You're going to die and go to heaven. Hallelujah. That'll make you happy right there. You see this guy over here in black? It's Johnny Cash. Oh my goodness, he's come in here, Johnny Cash. And this is Pastor Cash. And no, his name is Joel. Pastor Joel's really cool, really good. He looks slim and trim in his black. That's why I wear black too. But you look good. I don't, I just got a belly to hide. And so I want you to go with Pastor Joel right over there. He'll pray with you, only takes a few moments. People who came with, they'll wait for you. Make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel. Love you, Pastor Joel. Yeah, buddy.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.